crazy Americans are.
This week on Backward Compatible, Bradley James, a PhD student at Staffordshire University, joins us for a transatlantic dialogue on drugs, sex, and violence in gaming. Plus, thoughts on EVO 2015 and the Konami-Kojima breakup. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. Welcome to episode number 37 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined by Jim.
Hello.
And I'm joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And we have a special guest today, all the way from England. This is Bradley James. Bradley, how about you introduce yourself?
Hi, Bradley James, PhD student of game design and ludology. I've joined these lovely gentlemen for chatting about some games, because who wouldn't want to do that over their weekend?
it's always fun for us. Actually, we don't normally do it over the weekend. It's usually Wednesdays. So.
That's true. I like it when he says ludology. Say it again.
It's what I have to tell my family, because they don't get it. They're like, "Well, you do what now?" So I'm a ludologist. I'm like, it's got an ology on the end. It's fine.
Yeah,
exactly. See, when we say it, it just sounds, I don't know, American.
Mm. Yeah, it sounds a lot more fancy when you say it.
Yeah.
Ooh.
You add class to the word ludology.
I'm glad I can help with that.
Very cool. Well, I guess we'll go in and jump right in, and we're going to open up our first segment of today with a button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Thanks to recent events, I have been playing a lot more Smash Brothers than I should have recently, because I've been trying to catch up on I've got a little bit of downtime, so I've been trying to catch up on a lot of like normal games, but I found myself playing a lot of Smash since a lot of peers of mine at the university I work at, Staffordshire University, they've got a fighting game club, and they sprung on me. They were like, "We want to go to this fighting game club called VSF 7, I believe it is, in Birmingham, in the UK. And we really want to go along, but we don't want to go without you, because you're one of our best players." And I was like, "Oh, I haven't played in ages, so I've had to pick it back up, and I've been going on night times with some of the friends trying to train for it, basically."
Is this the Wii U version?
Yeah, Wii U version specifically. It's hard, because obviously the meta in that game changes really quickly, because it's still quite new. It's less than a year old. So it's shocking to see how the game has developed from what it was to what it is now. I'll be watching like gameplay online of like 3 months ago, and watching it like a day ago from like some big fighting game competition, and the level of difference and improvement is astounding. And I'm sitting there going like, how am I supposed to catch up with this? I have life to do. I can't do this. So I've been playing an obscene amount of that in order to try and get ready for it, so I can go there and not embarrass myself in front of lots of people.
Well, okay, so which character is your main?
I main Sonic the Hedgehog. Because I like his hit-and-run style. Sonic's style is very much sort of like, he waits for you to make a mistake, and then he rushes in and punishes it hard. And I like that, because as long as you play perfect, you can't get punished back, which is really nice. But obviously, that kind of hits a problem when you meet players who are more skilled than you, because they won't make a mistake as often as you will, so you have to sort of, you lose the punish game, and that's where he's best at. So I've been trying to play characters against characters I'm not really good at punishing, try and get an idea of how to work with them. But it's coming along okay. I'm known to bust out a Dr. Mario if I'm in a bit of trouble. Mainly because someone said, "Oh, you're doing a PhD, you've got to use the doctor." It became like a running joke. And then next thing you know, suddenly I'm really good with him. So everyone's like, "Oh, look, it's the doctor guy." And I'm like, "Oh, God, how did this happen?"
I do like Dr. Mario, how he has the down B that we lost when Mario and Brawl got the flood as the down B.
Yeah. It's really good. It's got really good kill power. Just hitting the damn thing is hard. It's got such knockback, so if you don't position it really well, you just send people flying before you get the main kill power, which is annoying. But he's never going to be as good as Mario, unfortunately, but I like him.
Very cool. Yeah, actually, I've been playing Smash Bros. For 3DS recently, because after that new DLC came out, I was really excited that Roy was coming back. So
he's our boy.
Yeah, I think I might have mentioned when we were in Germany, actually, my old main was Roy, and then when Brawl came out, I switched to Ike, because that was kind of like the next best thing. And now it's like I have Ike and Roy in the same game, and so I've just been trying to get back in the groove with him. Feels a bit different, but overall, it's really fun. I'm kind of like just getting the ropes again, and a lot of practice against CPU so far, but every time I have busted them out with players in local, everyone hates me because they're like, oh, you've got Roy
yeah,
again.
Yeah, he's really good.
Yeah.
He's really good. I really like Roy. Ike's been buffed as well, though, in the recent patch. Ike was really buffed, so yeah, he's still really good now.
Mm-hmm.
They're two very good characters. The DLC, Smash DLC is always good, though. I mean, Mewtwo was great. The three new ones are great as well. They weren't allowed at, they've not been allowed at any major competitions yet because they're so new.
Mm-hmm.
But I bet I can see them having a, all three of them. In fact, maybe not Mewtwo, but like all three of the new ones, Roy, Lucas, and Ryu.
Yeah, I'm curious to see how Ryu is going to affect the meta. Actually,
he's actually inspired a lot of Street Fighter players to come to Smash Brothers. Like when he was announced, a lot of the Street Fighter bunch were like, "Oh wow, that's super cool." And then they found out you can use his input commands from Street Fighter in Smash Brothers to power up his basic abilities. That hyped everyone, because like now you've got these players who are like super good at Street Fighter coming into Smash and kicking butt because they can input the commands better than we can, because we only have like two buttons and they're used to using like six, and we're like, oh god, I can't beat this Ryu because he's so good, and oh, it's really cool. So hopefully we'll be seeing some really cool matches between some like really high level Smash players and really high level Street Fighter players in Smash, which would be super cool to see.
It's time to hashtag get wrecked with some talk about competitive multiplayer games.
Doc, start us off.
All right.
Get wrecked.
Well, I gotta admit, this is a little bit like coming out of the closet, or, you know, standing up and saying, hi, my name is Doc, and I have played a PvP game.
Oh, well.
Because this is not what I do. My idea of fun does not include going online and being schooled by 12-year-olds, usually, and or bots.
You prefer them to be at least of age before they school you.
Yeah, pretty much. But I gotta say, I found an exception, mostly because there's not much that they can do to you if you're making mistakes. It is your own fault. And this is within the game called Rocket League. And it's a new game. It just came out this month. And what's interesting about it is it has nothing to do with rockets and it has nothing to do with leagues.
Perfect naming.
Yes, exactly. it is actually more accurately named by its predecessor, because this is a sequel to Supersonic Acrobatic Rocket-Powered Battle Cars, which, quite frankly, I think it should have been called Supersonic Acrobatic Rocket-Powered Battle Cars 2.
That sounds like a Saturday morning cartoon from the 80s, also.
Yeah, no kidding. With
which
bad
we
subtitles
would have all watched.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
with a
totally
name like that, we all would have watched that.
In fact, I'm kind of thinking maybe you know, Roll With It should just go ahead and run Supersonic Acrobatic Rocket-Powered Battle Cars, the role-playing game.
Mm.
I think our viewers would enjoy that, but
they might,
we'll
yeah
talk. We'll talk in meta. All
right.
To actually talk about the game, though, it is a physics-based vehicle soccer game, or as the rest of the world calls it, football. So what's cool about it is you're in a kind of an arena. The arena has sloped sides so that you could run up it with your RC car, and then it also has a roof which has sloped sides so you can continue going on your car. And if you're really, really awesome and you've leveled up your car, which of course is a thing, just like with all racing games or whatever, you can actually just go straight up the side, over the top, and down the other side, which I've seen like maybe one or two people do, and I'm not good enough to do it yet. But the cool thing about it is you have a little jump, and you also have a turbo boost, which can then, you think of it as fuel or energy or something like that, that you can, depending on where you, if you hit the little places, the right places in the arena, you can power it back up and get good at that. But the cool thing to do, if you're cool, is to jump and then actually spin your car, because you have full control of the rotation in, you know, the basically six axis type thing. And the neat thing of it is to actually jump up and then like punt the ball, which is three times bigger than the size of your car, and you can see these guys doing this, and just, the car will just jump up in the air and just like basically punt the thing with full control towards the goal.
It kind of reminds me of the Speed Racer movie that came out a while back.
Actually, yeah.
They called it Car Foo, and like they'd spin around and whack people with their cars.
You know what? That would be a much better title, actually, if it was just called Football Car Foo. I think it would be more accurate. But hey, you know, whatever. That is me playing online, and it's actually so good that I don't even care that the servers suck. So there you go.
There you go.
That's when you know you're playing a good game.
Yeah, exactly.
The server sucks, but the game's great. I'll play it anyway.
Did you say what platform it was on?
It's on PS4 and and Steam.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
You can get it on PSN, basically. Right now, you can get it free, actually, which is...
Yeah, I need to check it out.
Free on PSN?
Yeah. Yeah. I haven't checked it out, but I've got PSN, so I'm going to... Probably download that later today.
Yeah,
I'm gonna download that like as soon as we're done with this.
We can team up.
I don't want that.
The four of us go trash some bozos. That'd be great.
There you go. Yeah. Get wrecked.
All right. Well, let's move along. And while we're still talking about getting wrecked,
this is the Gaming Meta, news and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
Let's talk a little bit about the Evo Championship that's going on right now. Bradley, you were saying you follow that pretty closely?
Well, I follow part of it when I can. But yeah, for those who don't know, Evo is basically the biggest fighting game competition in the world. It's very prestigious, lots of money going around, lots of sponsorships, lots of salty rematches from players across a variety of games. We've got Persona 4 Arena, we've got Guilty Gear, Smash Brothers Melee, Smash Brothers for Wii U, Killer Instinct, Mortal Kombat 10, you know, Street Fighter, you know, all the big ones. And it's still going on, I believe, as we're doing this now. Hmm. But it should be over by the time you guys are hearing this. I do suggest, if you want to see some of the most amazing gameplay ever, to go and like look it up on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Or the repeats of some of the streams on Twitch, because it's been so good this year. The quality of gameplay from all games has been absurdly high. Like we've had some of the most amazing comebacks I've ever seen in my life. We've had some major upsets between some big players being knocked out by newcomers. We've had tech that we've not even seen before being on display from a variety of games. And in fact, in terms of Mortal Kombat, we've even seen like the most shocking thing of all. This one guy's just come in, and no one's taken a set off him. Just no one. Huh. He's come out of nowhere. It's this 17-year-old kid. I can't remember his name. It's like Sonic Fox, I think it is. His name is. He's come in, 17 years old, in Mortal Kombat scene, and has just wrecked everyone.
Nice.
Like everyone, all the way through. It's been amazing to watch. Like people struggling. These big like big names in the fighting game scene, just like, who's this kid? He's just wrecked me. Oh geez. So it's really cool so far. Really, really cool.
Very nice. Yeah, I remember I got sort of into Evo a while back, watching some of the replays on YouTube, specifically for Persona 4 Arena, because I wanted to see sort of how good gameplay on that looked, because I always played it just like solo on my PS3 and I'm terrible. And so it's like, what is good Persona 4 Arena gameplay look like? And it's some really exciting stuff on those tournaments, especially when you get into the semis and the finals and that all sort of stuff. Seeing the like the different combo strings, and it's interesting, you do start to see the metagame where it's all about kind of like who can find an opening and then just following up on the same combo every time, which in a way can be a little bit boring. But then when you're thinking more about kind of the tension of like, okay, who's going to get the first hit in, you know, that's usually pretty important, you know, counters and whatnot. So very interesting to watch the strategy unfold in those fighting games, which is way beyond my depth. So out of my depth.
It is really humbling as like a player. I mean, as I've mentioned before, I'm a big fan of the Smash Bros. Games, always have been, and it's really humbling to think, you know, I wouldn't say I was one of the best players ever. I'd consider myself an average player of Smash Bros. Games at best. But you watch these guys, you think, oh my god, I'm nothing. I am nothing compared to these guys. Like, oh my god. Like, there's one in Smash particular, for Wii U, there's a player called Zero. I think he's won 40 competitions in a row now, undefeated.
Oh, wow.
And it's insane. And he just took it. He just took it this year with a character that got completely nerfed in the latest patch.
Nice.
Everyone thought was unusable, and he just Diddy Kong was hit completely.
Oh, wow.
And suddenly busted him out in the grand finals and just won. Wow. And everyone sit there going like, he won with a character that he caused like the nerf of. What is happening?
Now, was Zero in the E3 tournament they did like before Smash Bros. Came out? I forget.
Yeah, he was the one who won that one. Samus. Yeah, he won it in a really salty way. He just stalled the clock out, and everyone was
"Dude!" I remember
became, like quite quote known about that.
Yeah, I remember watching that and being quite annoyed at that style of play. Because
it is one of those.
I really don't like it when people play that way. That's one of those, like, if you're sitting next to someone, you kind of smack them on the head if they're, like, your friend. Like, hey, dude, come on, let's
yeah,
play.
Yeah, you're just like, stop that. No, bad. But it is a style, unfortunately. I was really disappointed. Two of my favorite Sonic users, Static Manny and 6WX, two fantastic Sonic mains in Smash Brothers for Wii U, they both lost their sets in top 32 to stall out, because one of the best ways to beat a Sonic, in my opinion, is to stall him out, because if you can dodge, like I said before, he's all about getting that punish, but if you're not doing anything, like literally just running away from him, he can't punish that, if that makes sense, because you're just avoiding him. Mm-hmm. So if you run out the clock on a Sonic, they can't really do much. So both these two like really good players were stopped by effectively a timeout, and it didn't really cause a lot of people were kind of like, but you know, it was kind of ignored, and there was no real timeouts in the top eight, which was nice to see. I was really hoping there wouldn't be, but it was all hectic gameplay and really sort of aggressive play, which is always nice to watch. But there's not been a lot of timeouts this year, as far as I'm aware. Usually when there is a big timeout in a game, it's usually reported somewhere, like, this so-and-so just stalled out. Grr. I mean, there was a Killer Instinct one that got highlighted, but the guy brought it back. Like, he was in, he had, like, I think you couldn't even see this guy's health bar in Killer Instinct. You couldn't even see it. And he brought it back two games to the one he just lost at the start. It was it was incredible to watch. It was absolutely incredible. I think it's on like some like other news sites, some like video of it. But it was, I really hope people see that, because it was just awesome to watch. Awesome.
Very cool.
Yeah, that stuff always really is very, it's very humble for me, because I've never really been very good at fighting games. In fact, the last one that I felt that I was really good at was the Smash Bros on N64. If that tells you something, that was many years ago. So
I love that game.
Yeah. So I never really got that good at Melee, and then after that, I didn't really have time to play the Smash games to the point where I could feel like I was that good. I just sort of played them more casually. It's always really cool to watch some of the things that people can just pull off in these tournaments, and some of the crazy moves. Same thing with games like Street Fighter. I mean, the sort of things that the really top level players can do is pretty incredible.
It is. It's the thing is these top level players play the game like all the time, as you would expect.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they discover these, like, what to us might seem minuscule, but to them it's like that gives you the extra heart, like, frame of priority, or that frame of like movement, and they abuse it like live on stage, and they're like, how did he do that, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh my god. And like for in terms of Smash, my main area, we saw a game with Zero against Zero Suit Samus. And the Zero Suit Samus did a forward smash, which is a double kick forward, basically. And he managed to escape the second kick of the forward smash.
Mm.
And no one had ever seen it before. The commentator was like, how? What? He just did what? Like, he busted this little secret tech he knew how to dodge the second, the more powerful hit of one of these prominent main characters. And everyone's sitting there going, like, where did this? What? Hurt? How did he do that? And everyone's like, oh my god. And this, obviously, I think it was Nairo, the name of the character who was the Zero Suit Samus player. You could see him in the little screen where he was. He was just like shocked. He was like, huh? What? What? Like, he should have killed him, but he just didn't. And it was crazy. It was absolutely crazy. And people are like, that's, how did he, what? So now people are trying to learn how to do that, because it's obviously a thing. But it's such cool to see, like, how these little things, and that's why after every EVO, everyone's game steps up. You watch the games back and you think, how they do that, and you reverse engineer it, then you can do it. But by the time you've learned how to do it, they've learned how to do like 20 other things.
Sure,
not really. No, but that's the difference between like someone who pros it and like the casual players, isn't it? But it's still cool to watch, man. Oh my god!
Do you know if? Because I know Nintendo is doing releasing DLC of characters and doing updates. Are they? Do you think that they're paying attention to these sort of exploits in tournaments to actually go back and basically remove them, and or potentially add more by accident, that kind of thing? So it's always like an evolving process.
I think it's kind of that one. I feel like, as I mentioned before, Zero is really the prominent player, and he went to Japan. He was invited over there by the creator of the game, Sora Sakurai, and said, come to a tournament in Japan, you know, some of those players over here. And he went there with another famous Smash Bros. Player called Mewtwo King, and they went over there, and they dominated it. They won doubles together, and then Zero won singles, taking the set off, I believe it was Mewtwo King, in the finals. And they both used Diddy Kong, and mysteriously, in the next patch that was 2 weeks later, Diddy Kong got nerfed to hell. Like, absolutely nerfed. Like, everything that made him really good was kind of hit, and he was kind of eh. And, you know, and Sakurai has made, well, at least the creators of the game are really noticing what has made characters broken. Like there was a big meme in the Smash 4 community called "Let's Nerf Greninja," because Greninja had so many problems with his frames, with his movement, invincibility frames, and stuff like that. So they changed all of them. But by doing that, they made his gameplay terrible, because the best way to play him was to abuse these errors, so to speak. Mm. And then they nerfed him, and then they kept doing it because his moves are so weird. And so every single patch, Greninja's changed in some way, and everyone's like, "We better, well, Lil Max OP, better nerf Greninja," like, because that's unfortunately what happens. And it's, but other characters have received massive buffs as well. For example, Charizard originally wasn't that good. He didn't really have any good kill options, despite being massive and really powerful. But now his down throw was reduced in power, which sounds bad, but actually means he can now combo into it, which is great. So, and he's now become quite viable in the mid tiers, and so they are paying attention closely to it. And the DLC characters came in, and everyone thought, "Oh God, are they going to do the whole League of Legends thing? Let's break this new character completely, so everyone will buy him, and then, you know, we'll nerf him later on." But no, they've come in. They've been really, really well received. They've been really, really well balanced, and they're really, most of all, they're really fun and different to use, because everyone was really scared. They saw, "Oh, Roy, he better not be like Marth, Lucina, Ike, Robin, or a multitude of other fighting characters." But he's really different, really unique. Obviously, Ryu's really, really unique because the way he's control goes to Street Fighter, and Lucas wasn't a plain copy of Ness, which everyone hoped he wouldn't be, which is fantastic as well. So they're doing really good jobs. I'm really excited to see who they bring in next.
Yeah, for sure.
Because that is happening. They've got the Smash poll going to see what the fans want. My money hopefully is on Banjo-Kazooie. I'd really like to see them in the game, and I know that's a popular one, but ironically, the most popular one out of Japan is King K. Rool from Donkey Kong.
Yeah, I'm actually not surprised by that one. I think I've heard people since Melee pretty much winning K. Rool. So that's interesting, yeah. I wouldn't have thought of that one off the top of my head, but that another heavy character, another representative for Donkey Kong as a franchise, would that be
another
pretty cool?
Another villain.
Another
villain. That's super cool.
I would have liked to see Big Boss Wart, but that's, I don't know, maybe that's just me.
Wart would be cool. He's kind of the same thing, a big, bulky, villainous character.
Yeah, K. Rool is just a shameless copy of Big Boss Wart. Just a crocodile instead of a big toad.
I'm kind of holding out still for the return of Snake, because there was a brawl and hasn't been back, so...
He's a bit unfortunate due to the recent stuff with Konami and Kojima. We probably won't be seeing him, which is a shame. Big shame.
In fact, I did want to talk about that a little bit, actually. The sort of fallout with Kojima and Konami, to lead us into possibly some reckless speculation about the future of Konami and the future of Kojima.
Grab your salt shakers, because it's time for some reckless speculation. Our excuse to engage with rumors, hearsay, and all sorts of crazy theories.
There's been a pretty big fallout between Kojima and Konami. He's no longer with the company, to the point where he has asked them to remove his name from Metal Gear Solid 5.
Oh, wow.
That was heartbreaking.
Yeah.
That was absolutely... Have you seen the new... Konami released a statement with the official new front cover of the game.
Yeah.
And they've taken Kojima Productions off it. A Hideo Kojima game is off the front of it. And it looks sad.
It really does.
It genuinely looks sad. And I'm really, really upset about that. Because... we still don't know what happened. Like, no one knows. We've had rumors. We've had people talking about it. We've had, like, you know, we've got IGN and all those big names that are going, "Oh, we think this, we think that." We've had the inside scoop, this happened. But we've not had official confirmation on anything, as far as I'm aware, of what's happened yet. And it's distressing, you know. It's kind of hurtful to think that Kojima might not be with Konami making Metal Gear games anymore. It's sad. It is just sad. There's no other way of talking about it, really.
It's like, at least get through 5 and then sort of take your name off and all this different stuff. But now it's like, is the game that bad now? It's like, because if he doesn't even want to be associated with it, hopefully it's more a case that he's just had a falling out with Konami and the game's not terrible, you know, that sort of thing. But even so, that is sad. It's like, this is probably going to be the last Metal Gear Solid game, and there might be spinoffs and that sort of thing. But my understanding, my impression was that this was, I don't know really what else they could do, except maybe remake some of the old ones, as far as the story arcs go.
We still need to do our Metal Gear Solid, or just Metal Gear, if you will,
episode.
Yeah.
We stuck a big pin in that a couple.
Right.
And it came from, I think it was the comment where that I made that basically the series was bad. And Jim went red, kind of like he's doing right now. Smoke started coming out of his ears. And we stuck a big pin in it.
Series,
I'm a little scared of that episode. I might not live to tell the tale.
It'll
be recorded, though.
I do.
There will be evidence.
Yeah.
I don't like Metal Gear.
Exactly.
This is Snake.
You find yourself like knocked unconscious and like hidden behind a wall in a corner somewhere.
But we can stick a pin in that one.
Yeah.
And come back to it.
So let's go ahead and do some reckless speculation, and let's see what do we all think happened with Kojima and Konami. Why do you think he has left the company, Chris?
So my only guess, and I haven't been following this at all, is just that I remember after 4, he was saying he wanted that to be the last Metal Gear Solid, and mm-hmm. then a few years later. I think even after 3, he was saying he wanted that to be the last one, and then it's like, okay, well, 4 is coming out, so it's like, okay, he's already kind of gone back on that, but it's like, okay, for sure this time this is going to be the last one, and the Metal Gear Rising came out, and he wasn't so involved with that one, so it doesn't really count, but then they announced 5, and it's like, oh, cool, well, you know, we're glad there's another MGS, but, you know, I never thought he was actually going to do this, and so my understanding was that this was going to be the last one, so I kind of feel like it's, sort of a thing where he's sort of being forced into doing a thing. I think also there might have been something to do with after the kind of there was a lot of controversy surrounding Ground Zeroes when that came out, and I wonder if maybe he was trying to sort of push buttons that maybe Konami wasn't a huge fan of, and then that there was maybe some censorship, you know, some sort of creative differences, that sort of thing, where he didn't appreciate his vision being taken out of his hands.
Yeah.
And that might have been a big reason behind it.
I think that's part of it. I mean, if I could recklessly speculate a little bit, I think that it might have something to do with Konami's new direction. They're trying to push more into mobile markets and move away from the console space. They've been announcing more and more of that. And it's been happening around the same time that Kojima's had this falling out with Konami, so I got to thinking that there may be some sort of relation there, that perhaps they're trying to take the Metal Gear franchise into the mobile, more into the mobile space, and focus on in those areas as opposed to on consoles. And I could see Kojima, particularly since he's, you know, this is kind of his baby, his creative vision, and he might not really want it to be limited by you know, all the limitations on, say, an iPad or an iPhone or, you know, an Android device. So he might have really taken exception to that. And of course, as far as I'm aware, Konami does control the IP. So there's really not a whole lot Kojima can do about it other than, what he did, leave the company.
I mean, I remember I've just grabbed the quote that Konami said recently. They were asked directly, you know, is he still employed? And they specifically said he is still a Konami employee devoted with all his energy to Metal Gear Solid 5 The Phantom Pain. When furthering trying to question whether he's a full-time employee or a contract employee, the spokesperson replied, I'm unable to comment on the individual's type of employment. However, later on... that's very sort of like, ooh. But later on, they then said in a statement, it is true that during organizational change, there were more things that were revised. So it seems to be, because that was translated directly from the Japanese, so it feels like you're kind of, I think you kind of feel like what you're saying is right. Konami's new direction sort of didn't fit his sort of AAA orientated design. If I was to randomly speculate, though, I would say it's money. I honestly think something to do is with money involved, because I might be, because I'm really cynical now because I've gotten older, but whenever there's an organizational change, and I'm going to put that in quotations, that sounds like there was a dispute over money to me, because it happened so quick, and nothing quickly happens unless it's to do with money. And I found that out like the hard way in my life, is that if it's to do with like morals or design, we can work around it, and the money, no, out the door. So I feel like someone somewhere went, we want more money, we want this, we want that, and then someone went no, and then walked out the door. And whether it was Kojima saying to Konami, I want the rights to Metal Gear, give me the money, or they saying, we want to buy Metal Gear off you, give us the money, whatever, you know, something happened. It was just so quick. It was so quick, from like everything being peachy, look, the Phantom Pain, it's amazing, to with Kojima's out the door. It just happened too quick for me, and I'm a bit suspicious about that whole thing.
It's all very
sad. Okay, just speculation.
This is the reckless speculation segment.
Yes.
So we're allowed to recklessly speculate.
And the fun thing is that since we're talking about Metal Gear, and we're also talking about the potential for some sort of a wide conspiracy that could possibly cause the split between Konami and Kojima, so it could be something a lot more convoluted and complicated than what we're talking about here that would fit in pretty well with Metal Gear.
Kind of furious.
Oh, the irony.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
What I want to talk about today, actually, is Three Dragon Ante. It's one that's been on our radar for a while. Gosh, I think the first time I played this was has it been 10 years that it came out? But there's a new version of it that's out in the last few years that you can actually add to your original deck, or you can just play as a standalone game. And the idea behind Three Dragon Ante is kind of cool in that it exists fully within the Dungeons & Dragons universe. And so not only is it a card game, which, by the way, it has really cool sort of ergonomically shaped cards, I think. I find them really easy to hold, but then, you know, I have big hands and whatever.
Are they ergonomics because they're bigger or, like, they're tall?
Well,
or
yeah, they're kind of tall and skinny, but they also have curved sides. I mean, all cards, if you look at, like, a regular deck of playing cards, they have, like, curved-ish sides. But
you mean, like, the rounded corners?
Yeah, kind of rounded corners. Mm. But I like... you know, whenever you're holding cards in your hand, which is what this card game is all about, you know, I really like being able to see what I have in my hand and read it very clearly and all that. And so these cards are a little larger and tall and skinny, and they were well designed is what I'm trying to say. But the point is that Three Dragon Ante is non-collectible, so that's a plus for me. You buy it, you know exactly what you're getting. It's a standalone card game. On the website, it actually says that you can, quote, play it when you don't have enough time for a full-fledged D&D adventure.
Of course.
And so they're promising the fun of a full D&D adventure.
But it's not necessarily like the other board games where you can actually take your D&D character into the game.
It has absolutely nothing to do with that. Nothing whatsoever.
Unless you would imagine maybe that your characters are playing it in the tavern.
Unless you are dragons. Well, and that's the other thing, is that you can actually play it in-game, which is kind of interesting. If you've got a challenge that you want to do in-game and not necessarily roll it off and say, let's play a hand of Three Dragon. And you can actually whip them out and do it. It's kind of cool in that sense.
That's cool.
But what I really like it for is a six-player game that has a very cool mechanic, which is if you play the high card, then the ability that's on the card, which is dragon-based, it's color-based, if you will, suit-based, if you prefer, does not activate if you've played the high card. If you play a card that is actually lower than the card that was played before, then the ability does activate. And there's all kinds of things. There's evil dragons, there's good dragons, there's mortals, which can really mess with stuff. And your goal is to get the highest suit of the three. And then there's you can get like a color run, and you can get a number run, and all these other things that are special and fun. But the neat thing about it is you can actually build decks, certain types of decks, out of those preset cards, and play themed games. So last night we actually broke out the All Evil Dragon deck because a friend came and had both the original deck and the new deck. And so we were able to play with just evil dragons. And it really messed it up because lots of money changes hands with the evil dragons. Lots of stealing goes on, lots of exchanging, that kind of a thing. So if you're not into dragons, though, I would say that the closely related mechanically game would be Lords of Scotland. And that's the other one that I wanted to talk about. It also has that if you play lower, it activates mechanic. It activates the special ability. And what you're looking for is the high cards, and you get your suit. And if all of your clan are the same in the troops that you've mustered, we'll say. Again, it's a card game. But then all the points double. And so there's some really neat kind of strategy to that. Am I going to steal from you? Am I not? And I think where it really shines is also in that six-player version. You've got five rounds to a turn. The leader stays the same in the turn, and then you move on to the next one. Both those games are really cheap. They're easy to pick up for $15 to $20. I recommend you check them out.
Cool.
We've had a lot of fun.
Sounds cool.
Yeah.
All right, so shall we go in and transition into our main discussion?
Yes,
cool.
Let's do it.
All right, so Doc, since you kind of conceived this whole idea, why don't you go ahead and tell us kind of what it is we're going to be discussing?
All right, well, I lovingly call this topic the good, the bad, and the ugly. And what it's really about is those three things in the world of video game design.
And so... Specifically, what three?
The good, The bad and the ugly.
I was actually going to name them specifically, but well, I wanted to cut right to the chase and say we're talking about violence, drugs, and sex in games.
Okay, so that's
so
good.
Violence What's being the bad? Good, drugs being the bad, sex being the ugly.
Oh, and see, or there
is
we
that,
go.
Is that right? I
don't know. Well, I mean, in your case, sure, but
you crazy Americans all.
And that is exactly what I was hoping you'd say. We did not prime in any way for this, but actually, one of the things I said was, hey, we should really get a European on. Fortunately, we knew something.
Because we've got such a refined view of things like
this. Well, yes, of course. Yes. But no, where this came from was, for me, personally, and I can only talk about my personal experience here. Back in 2012, I had the opportunity to go talk at a conference in Oxford. And so one of the cool things about that conference was people from all over the world came. South America and over in Europe, and even some Africans, and it was really cool. And so what we had was this cultural mix, and the most surprising thing about this video game conference was people's reaction to sex and violence specifically. And what I discovered very quickly is that the American, let's call it presupposition, and I'm talking about culture and media here, mm-hmm. not necessarily gamers themselves, but it has made its way into there for sure, is that sex bad and violence, no big deal. Mm-hmm. And at least for me, with the people that were at the conference, it was the complete opposite. And it was,
yeah.
We need more sex. And it's fine. Sex is fine. But oh my goodness, that violence, that's going to cause so much problems. Mm-hmm. And so I don't want this to be a political debate about whether or not, you know, we should have a gun ban or gun registration or this and that. It's not about that at all. The question that I really want to put forward is the content of our games, which include adult themes, right, of all types. What if it is considered good? What if it is considered bad? And what if it is just plain ugly? And why?
And what do you mean by... Because, I mean, personally, I think that all of them have a place in the game if that's the way that it's designed, depending on how it's handled.
Let's talk meta with the ugly. Because in America, for example, you remember the big sex box fiasco? You remember what game that was about?
Oh, Mass Effect.
It was. I'm going to pick on Fox News a little bit.
Right.
Who doesn't
right.
want to pick on Fox News a little bit, though? Let's be honest.
I do.
It's this Fox, man.
That.
They set themselves up for it.
Yeah.
Well, true. Yeah, they do. But, you know, fortunately, my mother doesn't tune into this podcast that I know of. Because, you know, there's a lot of people in my extended family that, you know, that's their sole form of... infotainment. That's how they get their news. You know, and I do come from a conservative background. I come from a Christian background. I grew up as a missionary kid. You know, so a lot of this stuff is seeded into my personal psyche as well. But you know, one of the things that Fox did a couple of years back, it was to go, "Oh my goodness, this new game," and I challenge you to figure out which one it was. I'm curious if you know which one I'm talking about. But this new game allows you to, you know, sodomize and have sex anywhere, any way you want to. And it's on the Xbox, and we should ban Microsoft because of it. You know,
it smells like a GTA to me.
Oh, but it wasn't.
It's not.
Really?
Yeah, no, it wasn't.
It's not Mass Effect?
It was Mass Effect.
Okay.
Yeah, it was Mass Effect 2
really?
Specifically.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I thought it was 3.
Was it 3?
3 was the first one with, like, homosexual, like, between human, technically.
Yeah, but the scandal actually came out in 2.
Okay.
As I recall. I'll have to do a fact check on that one. But regardless, yeah, it was the Mass Effect series. Mm. You've gotten more granular than I knew.
See, when talking about Mass Effect, honestly, I really do get the effect in the way that they do relationships, mm-hmm. that it really is presented as sort of a, like, almost like a Pokemon gotta catch 'em all concept. Like, I really do feel that way, which is why I just feel the relationships in Mass Effect feel very shallow to me. Like, I was a big BioWare fan from way back in the day, and I loved the way that they handled your party interactions in the Baldur's Gate series. So I found them very lacking in their newer series, both Dragon Age and Mass Effect. I have felt that they've just because they now are a little more there's, I guess maybe you can say, I don't want to say standards is not the right word, but essentially there's been more. Relaxation of what they can get away with in terms of sexual content, and I think they saw a chance to, you know, create some controversy there and make money off of that controversy, which they have. And so they just kind of capitalized on it. And I think while they may have gained more freedom to, you know, show that content, I think they kind of backed away from some of the other stuff that they were doing. And because I know, I remember a lot of the relationships that I thought were the most interesting in Baldur's Gate were the non-romantic relationships between party members. But now when people play, it feels like they're always there, at least that's been my impression with the series. The focus really is on when you start the game, okay, well, which one am I going to, you know, try to pursue this time? Mm-hmm. As opposed to just having organic interactions with your party. I don't know, do you, I mean, I know you're a much bigger fan of these series than I am, because I personally couldn't get in them for that reason.
Yeah, no, I can definitely see the angle where you sort of approach it as like almost a dating sim, where you kind of decide at or very near the beginning of the game, which of these characters do I like, and which one do I want to try to have a relationship with. And I think that there are some things they do in those games that are trying, and, you know, they have some things where they try to make it a little bit more meaningful than just, you know, like, let's have sex, because sex is a thing that we can put in games now. But yeah, no, it's not particularly deep, and that's part of the problem with like trying to have a very deep emotional storyline that's sort of put into a fairly short game when you think about it.
And also a game that is a game series, both of them really, that are appealing largely to either teenagers or, you know, early 20-somethings. Mm-hmm. I mean, I say that it's not really fitting either. I know we don't really fit either of those categories, but I do know that those games are still very popular with that age group. And if you're, that's not exactly an age group that you associate with maturity. So that might be part of it too. I mean, maybe they're just kind of selling to their audience.
Looping back to why I don't play PvP.
There you go.
Well, the thing is,
go ahead,
Brad.
No, I was gonna say the thing is like at least over here, it's really strange how when games come out over here, we don't seem to have much of a problem with any sort of sexual stuff in games. It's really sort of, how do I put this? The disconnect between the gaming and the player is mainly focused on the violence over here. It's really strange. I think it's mainly, from an English perspective, if anything, I think it's because of the lack of sort of violence in our sort of society in general. I mean, a lot of the time, as you mentioned, we won't go into the whole gun debate, but you know, it's a big thing over here. One of the things we English people prize ourselves, our police force don't need guns. Oh, how brutish! You know, like it's really funny because sometimes you do get people who are like that. I mean, I don't really mind either way, but and so when we see these shockingly violent video games, it's all everywhere. But when you have sex in video games, because it's video games are still not really treated as like a serious thing in terms of, they're still seen as like a gaming thing. It's just, oh, look at them, it's polygons rubbing up against each other. Like when The Witcher 3 came out, and everyone was like, oh, good lord, you can have sex on top of a unicorn. Oh, everyone went, cool. But the fact you could decapitate people, they were like, this is poisoning the youth. And it's like...
But we have some of that, too.
Yeah. I was actually going to ask you about, specifically, about a game that I've been playing recently called Wolfenstein Old Blood. I don't know if you've played it, the new Wolfenstein game. It was a DLC that came out.
I haven't got around to playing that one yet, but I've played the original Wolfenstein.
Okay, well, it's quite violent, as you can probably imagine.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Of course, the violence is directed at Nazis, and later in the game, Nazi zombies. So it's not like you're going around killing innocent people, but at the same time, it is a very violent game. And I have read before that, particularly in Germany, they're very... they crack down a lot on gaming violence, so I imagine they probably couldn't play Wolfenstein there. Do you know any more about that? Or
it is really funny. Germany in itself have very, very anti-violence in anything. For example, I don't know if you guys know the game TF Team Fortress 2.
Yes.
Valve, really popular shooter game. We all know that's real mercenaries blowing each other up, bloods and guts and so forth. But when I was really into the game, when it first came out, I did a little bit of research into it, and I started looking up the different trailers, just for funsies. And I noticed something really odd about the German one. For some reason, when they exploded, their blood was black. And I was like, what? So I did a bit of digging, and it turns out, to get the game sold in Germany, and subsequently, later on, Australia, they had to imply that the mercenaries in the game were robots.
Oh, wow.
So they made it so that their blood in the trailers was oil, and they made it so that their guts were springs and pieces of metal. And I was just like, that astounded me. I was like, really? Really? And as me and Chris found out, you know, when you're in Germany, you know, the topic of Nazis, you don't want to go near. We were sitting at a dinner table and we were just chatting away like we were, like we are now, and it came up, and then everyone around that table became very consciously aware of where we were right now. And we're like,
because I mentioned Wolfenstein, everyone's like,
don't mention that. It was pretty much, we laughed, but that was pretty much, it was like, so on the topic of Nazi, oh, and everyone around the table went, oh no, stop him. it's a good way to get service though.
If your server's not paying attention to you, just kind of stand up, Nazis, and then like everyone turns and looks
just
at you.
Just sit
and then,
down, drop the mic. Yeah. But no,
Wolfenstein.
But it's funny because it is very odd like that. I think a lot of things like that. I mean, in terms of censorship and sort of things like that, they are very. I think it's because it's very precise to Germany, especially when you're talking Nazism and stuff like that. It's very obviously for them. It's a very big sore subject, mm-hmm. as you would imagine.
Are they the same way with movies?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, for example, not just violent movies, but also like Inglorious Bastards. I assume that didn't play in Germany.
It did play over there, but it was heavily censored. Mm-hmm. If I remember correctly, I believe it was heavily censored. But they censored movies as well. There are just some very few countries in Europe that go all out on the censorship, like all out. Germany being one of them. Australia is obviously a very notable one for the high tax on games and stuff like that. But at least you know, other countries like England and France are much more liberal with what they show. It's a cultural thing. It's very strange because Europe's obviously made up of so many diverse cultures. Mm-hmm. You know, you walk across the border from France into Germany, and the change is immediate and noticeable. And that applies for their media as well. Like France is very open and actually quite accepting of sex a lot more than other countries. But then you know you come to England and we just don't care about sex, but violence is everywhere. It's like, oh, you know, can't have that violent. And drugs is really strange. Like there's some more northern parts of Europe are very like, you know, drugs, who cares, you know. Mm-hmm. But the like sort of south end of Europe are sort of like, no, drugs are bad. And mm-hmm. it, you see it all the time, and various sort of companies will have outrages here and there about their games doing this or their films doing this or whatever. And it's odd to see. It's hard to keep up on. It really is. It's you know, you hear about a game coming out like say Wolfenstein, and you think to yourself, oh cool, it's gonna be great, and then you think, oh man, what's Germany gonna think of this, what's France gonna think of this, what's Spain gonna think of this, and they probably all think something completely different. But what's strange is as me and Chris found out when we were up in Germany is that how a lot of the tropes and sort of stereotypes of the world in general in this in terms of game design remain constant for all the countries, like we, and that applies to their games as well. Like we were saying, like the Germans now almost expect themselves to be demonized as Nazis in games. It's mm-hmm. pretty much funny. They were saying like, we expect to see a game come out and go, how do we justify the main character killing hundreds of people? Sod it, make them Nazis, make them evil, sod yeah. it, make them drug sex filled Nazis, go kill them all. And and they look up, and when I asked a couple of them what they thought of it, they just went, eh. like it seems like the people in the know over there, like when the game designers, just like, we just take it now, it's yeah. fine, like we get it, we get it, haha, easy target, you know. It and I think they've kind of got to, but obviously the general public obviously aren't the biggest fans. You can imagine their news reports aren't exactly, and now report on the newest Call of Duty game, oh look, they're killing Nazis again, joy, more German rich. people.
So who makes that decision? I mean, over here in the US we have something called the ESRB, mm-hmm. which for those who don't actually know how the way it works, companies send in three videos, they send in videos, mm-hmm. To three people, so it's three sets of videos, and it's supposed to be the worst content. So what's interesting is the developer themselves actually said, you know, decides what the worst content in their own game is, then three independent, well-trained people will say, this is what I think the rating is, this is what I think the rating is, this is what I think the rating is, and that's what the rating is. That's how we do it.
It's Peggy over there, right?
Peggy and BBFC for England as well in some okay. cases, but each country has their own sort of individual one. But the way mm. I believe it works over in Europe, at least for us, France and I believe Spain, I'm not quite sure on this one, I'm probably going to need to fact check on that, and I'm not sure about the other countries because I've not looked into them. The way we do it is we have the board of Peggy or whatever, and in the country they send a copy of the game early mm. to them, and they say, right, here's a full copy of the game, and they get specific playtesters to play through the game and make notes of certain parameters. So, is this too violent? Is this too sexist? Is this too drug use? Is this too rapey? You know, things like that. And they write it down, and then depending on what is boxes are ticked, what parameters are reached, that's how it gets its rating on the back of the box. It's very sort of more in depth than the average person thinks it is. Like they think it's just, oh, we told them it's violent, it's got drugs, and it's got this. Oh, it gets the 18. But no, there have been occasions where people have gone, that game's, Jesus, that game's violent. Oh, and then it comes out 15. And I was like, really? And I was like, yeah, it's 15. Because it just didn't hit that parameter.
So do they have, at a certain point, does the PEGI board, do they actually ban a game if it is too much? It's, or do they just slap it with a high enough rating that it's restricted?
Usually,
the ESRB doesn't ban games.
Here. No, we have an what is it? AO.
AO.
And it'll get sold by Walmart. So
it basically, it keeps it from going out to some of our bigger retailers, like box and mortar retailers, like Walmart. But it doesn't actually ban it. You can still get it. But do they actually ban over there?
No. Usually, what happens is very rarely, if a game hits a parameter that's a bit too much. I won't speculate what could be possibly too much because that might go down a dark road, but usually they send it back going, look, this is unacceptable. You cannot have this. And then usually they will change that part of the game. Most of the time it will be something like, you know, panning the camera away or, you know, just leaving the sound effects in or implying it or whatever. But it will still remain in, but it just won't be shown. Very, very rarely does that happen. Very, very rarely. Because we've become... I'd say in the modern age we've become quite liberal in what can be shown. I mean, when I was in university, we were having a discussion with some of the students about what was acceptable to show in a video game, and we had a more, obviously, as you would expect, a more biased mix towards men than women. But we had some women in there as well, and I raised the point of saying, like, who would be fine with seeing a rape in a video game? And almost everyone put their hands up. And I said, okay, who would be okay with seeing a child die on screen in a video game? And maybe like two people put their hands up. And I said, okay, why is that one more acceptable than that one? And they went, it was a kid. That was the only explanation. And it feels like that's sort of the sort of thing that these people watch out for. There's that, these unwritten rules, like, that you just can't show. Like, you can show a rape as long as it's relevant to the story and the narrative or imply rape, but you don't touch kids. Mm-hmm. In every sense of that phrasing.
It's like, kind of like how, it was probably the same over there, but over here I know in Skyrim you had to get a mod to be able to kill children.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I bet you any money.
Same thing in Fallout, and I know that was something that actually, I think at a certain point Bethesda had to be doing it on purpose, because they made the kids in both of those games so obnoxious.
Like, they wanted to kill them.
They would wantonly do things like they would like, I mean, in Fallout 3, for example, you found this little, I forgot the name of it, but this little town, like, little lamplight or something like that, and it was basically a town run by kids, and they would openly, like, dare you to kill them, and they would act like they were so tough.
Yeah, I remember this.
Just, they were, like basically begging you to shoot them, and they're like, oh, but you can't do it, can you? Like, stuff like that, like, acting like, and as though just almost got really meta with it. And the same thing in Skyrim, like that one little girl would just run around, and she'd come up to you, and she'd... You know, it's the sort of things that you would never, like, a kid would actually not do that. If a guy is walking around, like, you know, and they have a,
like a machine gun.
Yeah, an RPG that shoots out mini like a mini nuke, like you do in Fallout. You're just walking around with this. No one, not an adult.
Just folks up, pokes him, like, screw you, dude. Yeah. You wouldn't do that. You just wouldn't do that.
Or in Skyrim, you're walking around and you have, like, armor, and your armor's covered in blood because you've, like, just killed, like, all these, you know, people or monsters or dragons or whatever, and you have, like, giant sword on your back, and you're just kind of walking around looking really badass, and everyone's getting out of your way, and then some kid just runs up and starts, like, bullying you, essentially. It's really strange.
As a professional,
it must be meta.
I think I've met some of those kids, actually, who would run up to you.
You've met the inspiration for them.
Darwin Awards.
And normally what would happen is, like, the kid would get slapped or something, and you'd go about your day.
Well, that's true.
But you can't do anything to them. You can't... There's no, like... punishment or anything, so it comes across like they're almost taunting you, which I think is why those mods got made in the first place. I don't think they would have gotten made if the kids were not as obnoxious. Plus, the fact that, honestly, when you have things like dragon attacks going on in town and the kids are just, like, frolicking, just acting like nothing's going on and frolicking.
Dragon's like,
people
are dying, but fire, and they're just standing there going, like, I can tank this, it's fine!
right. It's like, why are you running
I've
away, mommy?
I've specced the tank,
daddy?
Guys, it's cool! I do agree. It's the thing about this is that, it's like they said, the disconnect is that, you know, children are the untouchable things, especially over here in Europe.
Right.
The violence factor is a huge thing.
But they're not actually kids. They're just polygons, you know? It's like,
this
it's
is the
real.
Point. See, I've been a very, very big advocate of the fact that this is absolute bull. Because if you've got a game like, say, GTA, where you can literally just go around and kill everyone, what's the problem with killing a kid in a game? It's a polygon. You know, and people say, oh, it's gonna warp the youth. I said, it's an 18 game. Mm-hmm. It's an eight. It's got 18 on
it. Sorry, go ahead.
No, sorry. I was going to say this is my biggest problem with this topic of the good and bad and ugly is that we talk about it and we know what we're talking about. We've all been designing games. We've all played a lot of games and. We say these things and we go, yeah, we know that this isn't bad. We should be able to kill kids in video games. And then if we were to give this podcast to, say, an average parent who has, say, a child and they've let them buy a console, that parent would go, oh, he can kill children? Oh!
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, unplug it, chop up the wires, throw it in the bin. And it came highlighted to me recently because I went on local radio in Stafford. And I went on local radio to talk about my university and the game design course we do, as well as, like, talk about esports and various other things like that. Mm-hmm. And one of my co-hosts was this woman who, from the outset, I knew she didn't know anything about games. And I asked her, you know, what's your experience with games? She goes, well, if I was to say anything, I'd refer to myself as Penny from The Big Bang Theory. And I went, oh, my God. Oh, my God. And that whole segment then became 2 hours of me sitting there having to explain to a woman who was so bigoted in her view about the games industry because she heard the word sex, violence, drugs mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
It was asinine. It really, really was. And then it occurred to me, I was like, this is the current view of parents. This woman is just a normal woman. She's just a normal, lovely lady with a kid. And this is her view, you know? She doesn't know about parental controls. She doesn't know that these 18 games actually do contain violence, sex, and drugs. And then, you know, I said to her, would you buy your son an 18 game? And she says, of course. And I go, would you buy your son a porno? She goes, well, no. And I go, well, they're both 18. What's the difference? One's a kid's toy. I was like, but it's got an 18 on it. Well, that doesn't count. And that sort of disconnect is prevalent around the world, and it's and it just so happens that in terms of this argument, it seems that different countries have just different problems with different bits. Like as I've mentioned frequently over here, violence is a big deal over here, and you know, but over in America, it seems the sexism more of a weird thing. And I bet you any money that in other countries they'll be like drug use, no, but sex and violence is fine. And it's really strange.
So let me. Can I ask how old was this woman?
I think she was in her early 40s. In her early 40s.
Okay. Because I would speculate that as people in our generation start having kids and that becomes more like the majority of parents. I know Jock already has one, but he's not old enough to play video games. that we being people that were raised into gaming would probably have a better understanding and knowledge of rating systems.
Absolutely.
And content in games, and I think that will kind of help fix things. I know that gaming really is still sort of in its infancy in terms of media. I mean, it took a while for movies to really get to the point where people realize all the different content that can be in movies and all the different things that you can do with a movie. And I think games are still kind of learning, still finding their footing.
Yeah, very much so. This is something. Yeah. This is what I postulated on the radio. I said, you know, we are an industry that's only roughly around 30 years old. You know, we've not had time to spread our wings to the extent of, you know, radio, TV, and film. You know, you walk into a house these days, like a standard family walks into a house, and they see a TV, they're like, oh, that's cool. They see a home cinema system, they go, that's great. They see DVDs, they see Blu-rays, they're like, cool. You see a game console, and they go, what's that thing doing there? You know, even now we have this. This
stigma.
Culture where the stigma and it's going to stick around for a long while until, like you said, I very much believe that when our generation, who grew up with the console wars, with the advent of the SNES, the Mega Drive, or the Master System, as whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. Genesis, I believe you guys called it. You know, that era of child is now becoming a parent, and they're going to teach their kids this stuff properly. So when mm-hmm. when I get older, you're damn sure I'm putting parental controls on my child's console. I'm going to go straight on and go, your PS6, your PlayStation 6, right, get the parental controls on. You ain't playing. Because I know, I've seen it, and I wouldn't want my child, like, who's 12, playing 18 games. I wouldn't.
Sure.
But, you know, and because we're educated, and not even, I mean, even to a lesser extent, we are, as I've mentioned before, we are highly educated people in terms of games and games design. Even the average person now, who, even if they're the standard gamer who plays, like, a metric ton of, like, Madden and FIFA and COD, even they will know to do that, because they've grown up with it. And, you know, our parents, and for lack of a stent, the current generation parents, just don't get that. And it's a frightening situation. And it's something that, why I really did want to come and talk to you guys about this subject is because, you know, we are the kind of people who need to turn around to these people and say, look, you know, we get that it's bad, but you shouldn't be giving that game to your 13-year-old if it's got an 18 on it. You know, mm-hmm. things like that. And this is the subject that I've always tried to push. When people come up to me, you know, and say, oh, your industry poisons children. And I go, did you buy your child that game? And they go, yes. And they go, you've poisoned your child. Mm. Don't look at me. You're pretty much shooting the messenger at this point. I mean, you know, to refer back to the lady in the interview I had, she said to me, you know, I didn't know that the console was online. He could be solicited by perverts. And I said, you realise that's the equivalent of saying that if your child was abducted off the street, you're going to blame the pavement he was standing on. Because it's just a medium. It doesn't make any sense to do that. And I feel like you're right. When we do get to this stage where we do have kids, and we will be a lot better with that. And that's going to happen with time. You know, mm-hmm. that's something we can only advise, and we can only tell, like, listeners and you know, people they talk to, you know, to advise this stuff. We can't do it until we're actually there, which is really frustrating. Because I pretty much get it every day. Because I'm quite active on Twitter, I'm quite active on social media. Obviously, I've got friends with their parents, and it comes up, and they go, "Oh, you know, why do you have to make these horrible games?" And I deal with it every day, and it's something that bothers me. And I do get the whole sex, the whole drugs, the whole violence thing thrown in my face all the time, and luckily, I do have the appropriate retorts, shall we say, like ready, like there, like I've got this, bam, research paper, go, games are good.
Because I know we've talked a lot about the sex and the violence, but we haven't really talked much about drugs, drug use in games.
Yeah.
I did want to talk some about that. I know that one of my earliest experiences with drug use in games was the Fallout series, mm-hmm. which did a pretty interesting thing, even going all the way back to the first one, where you could do drugs and they would give you a stat boost, essentially. They called them chems, actually, not drugs.
Yeah, they did.
You could do chems and they would give you some sort of a stat boost or bonus. However,
so they were desirable.
Right, they were desirable, but they would also come with the negative potential for addiction.
And withdrawal.
And then withdrawal, because once you were addicted and you had to keep doing them, which, of course, was a drain on your money.
I got addicted to Nuka-Cola.
Yes,
so bad.
You can get it, and it was really neat that they did that, and of course that's something that carried over into the new Fallout games, Fallout 3 and New Vegas. Then, of course, the other big example that I have for drugs, and we can talk about all this, but the other big example I have for drugs is actually GTA, which GTA is really great about hitting all three of these. GTA has gives you the ability to drink a lot, drink alcohol to excess, but also it has various instances of drug use, such as marijuana, LSD, cocaine in some of the games, depending on the setting and depending on the storyline. And sometimes these are presented as related to, obviously, part of the storyline. You know, I believe in San Andreas, you were trying to transport large quantities of marijuana via a plane, a crop duster, I want to say, and it got burnt and released, something like that. And I know in Vice City there was cocaine and cocaine transportation, because that was very heavily influenced by Scarface.
Yeah.
But in the newest one, in GTA 5, of course, you also just have recreational drug use, where you can just kind of go around, aside from going to a bar and just drinking, there's also that little guy, the guy that tries to push marijuana legalization on the side of the road.
Oh, yeah.
But anytime you actually like try to take a hit, you end up like completely, you're on like LSD or something, like you're completely tripping off, like just tripping your balls off. You're seeing like crazy aliens, and you're, I don't know if you've played GTA 5, but it's completely wild, and you know the way that it presents it, but it's all sort of done with a very tongue-in-cheek, not very serious, especially with, you know, the whole, I mean, that could even be a joke on things like Reefer Madness and the overreaction to marijuana, possibly. It might be what they're doing with that wild trip with all the aliens and all that. I'm not sure. Or it could just be a joke. I don't even know. With Rockstar, everything they do is so satirical that sometimes you can't even tell if they're even trying to make a point with it or not.
That is the biggest problem with that, with the GTA series. And so it is all based on satire. Like, the whole game of GTA 5 is basically just a huge satire on America. And I always found that brilliant how... Because obviously GTA is made almost predominantly in the UK, in Rockstar North. And they nail, like, satirical American culture so well that Americans buy it and go, LOL! And then they don't realize that technically they're laughing at themselves, but it's kind of, and that's never funny.
It's brilliant, though. No, I think brilliant. It's brilliant. And they do a great
job. Much respect for that company to be able to pull off that every time with a plan. But you are right, and it is... Games really do handle drugs in such weird ways. You get stuff like Fallout that does it really well. I love that system. I love that system for that. Like, it's so true to life almost. You know, you do get a big hit off drugs. You know, I know I've personally never done any drugs in my life, but I know people and I have friends who have, and you know they will say, you know, we're chatting, and I was like, you know, that's exactly like Fallout is exactly how you feel. You know, you get it, you feel great, you're awesome, and you're amazing, and they do that in the best way. They make your stats go up. That makes the player feel awesome. And then he's like, oh damn it, I've got no money because I have to buy more chems, because if I don't buy more chems, I don't get these awesome stats. Damn, ah, oh, that's really sucky. And then, because that's exactly kind of what happens in real life, you get a hit and then you're like, oh, I've got no money. But yeah, drugs are, it's so hard to talk about drugs in games because some games do them really, really well and other of them do them in such a satire. I've never played a game which does them seriously enough, if that makes sense. Like, because I remember a game called do you remember a game called House of the Dead Overkill that came out in the
world? Yes.
That game was absolutely off its tits crazy, and there was like a scene where a guy in a wheelchair started stabbing himself with a needle in his arm, and it looked so bizarre and stupid. He's like, drugs, I need these drugs now, and he starts stabbing his arm with them. And he's like, I'm sitting there going, what am I watching? And on the back of it, it said like a huge thing, drug warning, trigger warning for drugs. And I'm like, is that really drugs? Like, I don't really, I feel like drugs, out of all the three topics here, are the one that is in the most flux, because we don't kind of know what we mean by drugs. Do we mean some object that you take that's like a drug, or something that gives the effects of a drug, or implied drug taking, actual drug taking? It's all over the shop. I mean, what game was it? There was a game, I cannot remember for the life of me what game it was, but I remember looking at it. It was like a game, like a kind of like a Dante's Inferno-ish game. Like sort of like Devil May Cry sort of game. I can't remember what it was for life, but I remember looking at it and going, that does not look like it should have drug on the back. Yep, it's got drug on the back. What the hell? And I asked a friend of mine who played it. For the life of me, I can't remember what it is now. I'm really going to kick myself. But he said, Bayonetta, no drug use in it. Huh?
Bayonetta, maybe?
Maybe. I think it might have been Bayonetta, but I had drug warning on the back. And I was like, why? Is there drugs in it? Because she drinks a vial of something at one point. And something happens, and I'm like, really? Like, what? And it's like, and it's really strange. Like, you know, violence and sex have been very much determined. Like, you know, there is, like, you know, there's a sex scene, and sex is in it vaguely, you know. But drugs, it's all over the shop. Because, I mean, technically, if you want to be pedantic about it, if we drink a potion in an RPG, that's technically a drug.
Yeah.
You are drinking a object to change your physiology for a moment, and, you know, it is technically a drug, and I don't know how far that can be pushed.
You can also get very drunk.
Yeah, that's true. Technically, and I think drugs do fall under alcohol as well. So games that have lots of alcohol, they just slap a drug sign on it. They don't go, oh, alcoholic references. They go, oh, drugs.
Well, actually, we do have both. We'll say
We have it written, but the drug symbol's still there, which is really weird. So we have drugs and then alcohol. And it's like, that's not right. But it's just, I find it's that one's really difficult to talk about, because you look at games and you're like, they've drunk a thing, that's drugs, but this game they're doing meth and that's not what, and it's very strange, and it is the oddball. I can bet you there's probably a country somewhere that gets really, really annoyed about them. The world is so huge and diverse, and there's so many different countries. I bet you somewhere there's one country that's like, no drugs, no.
GTA does its best to try to be as controversial as possible in all categories, so just in case there is one that doesn't really like the drug use but it's okay with the other two, they'll still not like GTA, so it's okay.
I don't think any media company likes GTA. I think that's their job description. They get a message to go, new GTA, right, we instantly don't like it. Now let's talk about it. It's quite funny to see. But yeah. I don't know, drugs are always an iffy subject in games. Because, to be honest with you, sometimes they're just not needed. I mean, sometimes you can have a legitimate story where there is lots of violence and there's lots of sex, but adding drugs in just seems like overkill. You know, and I feel like they are the overkill button. Like, how do we want to make this villain look more bad? Let's let him do a line of coke or something. I don't know.
It'll be like he's dealing drugs to kids. That was the classic way back in, like, you know, 90s TV shows. You wanted to have a villain that was like the bad guy when you're normally out, like any sort of crime show. You wanted to make a guy like the extra bad guy. Well, he doesn't just deal drugs. He deals drugs to kids. You know, there's always that element.
I'm reminded of the kids. The 80s, 90s video game movement, especially in the arcades, to like do the you know, winners don't do drugs and that sort of thing.
Yeah, that was so huge. We didn't have that. Mm-hmm. We didn't have that here.
There's actually a really excellent episode of JonTron, if you've ever heard of that.
I know exactly what episode you're talking about.
Yeah. He's showing like all these sort of anti-drug games from back in that day. And some of them are pretty ridiculous, and a lot of them are really poor quality. And they almost like fail horribly at getting the point across. I think like one of them is basically just to shoot them up, mm-hmm. or you're a drug cop, and essentially you're just like using like insane excessive force against like this horde of people who are all cracked out or something like that. And it's like
you're dealing drugs, better shoot you. Ooh. That was amazing.
That's a good episode. I'd recommend checking that out.
So we've done a really good job of looking at the bad. We've talked a lot about how it gets ugly, but we haven't focused at all yet on the good. And I know that's a broad thing. One could argue that every week we talk about the good, mm-hmm. but I want to actually read you a quote from Katie Salen, which is Rules of Play, if you know that mm-hmm. textbook. Everybody who's an academic should probably know Salen, and maybe probably has even quoted Salen. But here's one of my favorite quotes. Games are always played somewhere by someone for some reason or another. They exist, in other words, in a context, a surrounding cultural milieu. The magic circle, in quotes, is an environment for play. The space in which the rules take on special meaning. But the magic circle itself exists within an environment, the greater sphere of culture at large. Okay, so this idea is almost 20 years old now, so you can find people who have referenced mm-hmm. Salen's work, including myself. But what I think is interesting about this idea of the magic circle is I think it does a really good job of explaining what we've just been talking about, which is why it is that a European audience might have a different reaction to an American audience, to a Canadian audience even. But what I think really it comes down to is when you're talking about game culture, which is actually a microculture of the various cultures at large, right? So you take these individuals who exist within their own culture, and then you put them into game culture, and then because everything is online, it becomes cross-referential, and game culture becomes its own thing, mm-hmm. which is really, really cool. One of the best definitions I've seen is that game culture is four things. It is cultural rhetoric, it is open culture, it is cultural resistance, and it is cultural environment. So I want to wrap up today by talking about those four things. First of all, game culture is cultural rhetoric. So literally, it allows us to talk about the larger culture. Do you think that's true?
I think 100% so. Agree.
Yeah. And just like any other entertainment media, movies, books, et cetera, even if people don't take games seriously or don't treat them as art, or if they, don't care to or they don't want to, I think they are, and they are becoming increasingly more so. And eventually we're going to get to the point where games are taken just as seriously as movies or any other form of media. Of course, they're going to be the ones that aren't meant to be taken seriously, just like with anything. You know, we're not going to do an in-depth literary analysis, cultural analysis of the random sitcom just came out this month. But the more serious games, things like GTA, for example, that are meant to be kind of a commentary on stuff that's going to be something worth discussing and worth looking at, and something that's meant to evoke thought about the culture.
And discussion.
Yeah.
Which is the part of, I guess, rhetoric.
Mm-hmm. GTA is a really good example of that, and I think it deserves to have that level of discussion about, because it does such a good job at sort of reflecting American society in a satirical way. I mean, it's funny, but it also raises a lot of issues about things that might be wrong with our culture.
It's a bit of a funhouse mirror if it's a reflection, but I'll give it to you. Yeah.
Right. You know, what satire is. So it's just kind of, it's absolutely really, you know, amping it up and presenting it in a way that is intentionally kind of ridiculous, but you kind of, you know, you step back a moment after you laugh and you go, well, actually, that's kind of true.
It's one of those things. I mean, a lot of my work in my doctorate has been about this cultural convergence that I believe is coming very soon for games. I mean, we are reaching this tipping point now where we cannot, as an industry, afford to be taken so lightly anymore. You know, like as Chris said, you know, we are going to get to that point eventually where we are respected as much as films and TV are, and it's important that the games that come out that do eventually blend into our cultures and societies are of a high enough standard and get this level of like of good game design, like GTA satire, like, you know, like these Fallout's drug use system, like this stuff which is proper and decent and good and beneficial in a sort of really weird roundabout ways, even if they initially seem negative. Because, you know, these are the games that will blend into our culture. These are the games that people will remember. Like, we talk about the classic films that cemented the film industry. We talk about the classic TV shows that cemented the TV industry. One day, we're going to be talking about the classic games that cemented the game industry. And we don't want these games to be violent shooter with no apparent reason behind it 12. You know, we want them to be these beautiful experiences that people can look back on and go, my God, wasn't that beautifully implemented? And when we talk about like cultural rhetoric, it's going to take a very clever game, like on the level of GTA, perhaps maybe even a new GTA, to be that bridge, that type of game which can be like sent out worldwide and everyone can take something different from it, but it's all really good. Like we mentioned GTA over here, we find it hilarious because it's poking fun at America. You guys find it funny because it's a self-referential poke at yourself, and that's great. And Japan love it because it's like, oh, Western design is brilliant, but look how stupid it was. And it's great how that sort of, but they do, though, they generally do. Yeah. They look at it and they go, it's Western design, it's mental, but oh, you know, they take it as a big bit, like as a whole as a joke. They don't believe any of it's real. They think it's like a massive joke. And it's great that that's sort of there. And I really strongly believe that is coming soon. And we really need to focus on these positive points to really put into game design.
Yeah, and I do think that that sort of a game, that sort of a tipping point, is going to have to come from... It's going to have to be a game that is very popular and widely received. Because I know there's been talk about, in terms of particularly the games as art movement, and there's been talk about it, you know, oh, it's going to come from the indie game space, and I don't really think that's true, because if you look at film, if you look at the movies that really got the attention, it was the ones that actually made, you know, had the mass appeal, and that sort of forced everyone to kind of look at it, like, you know, for example, like Citizen Kane, forced people to look at the film industry in a different way. And you can't do that if it's this small game that only a few people play, that only hits a niche audience. It's going to have to be one that is so widespread and so popular that everyone kind of has to play it, or at least has to be aware of it.
And going back for a second to what you mentioned about, you know, even these games that, like, you know, drug use, for instance, even if it's sort of seen in a negative light at first, you actually go back and say, like, oh, this is a really good system for sort of teaching a lesson. And that's something I think games do really well, is they teach. People learn things through games. And actually, that's Ralph Koster in A Theory of Fun kind of defines fun as that moment when something clicks in your brain and you learn something, you master a system.
Good reference.
It's like, you know, the drug use thing. You learn that, like, in this game, you have to manage the addiction. Well, relate that to real life. Maybe I don't want to manage that addiction in real life, or I don't want to be hyper-violent in real life because I've learned what that's like in the game.
Yeah, Ralph Koster, the second. Great guy. I just want to say Ralph Koster, in terms of happiness in games, He said, I can't remember the exact quote, but he pretty much said that the enjoyment is actually kind of almost secondary to the experience. Like, you want to go out, when you talk about a game, the first thing you do is say, oh, it was brilliant, and then just leave it. You say it was brilliant because of this. You say it was brilliant because I loved this. You don't say it was, no one ever says a game was wholly brilliant. They always go, I love the gameplay, I love the story, I love the thing. And that's something I believe, like, extends onto what you're saying, that people will remember, like, I love the fact they implemented this, I love the fact they did this. And that game, which we were mentioning before, that we eventually blend into culture, will be that thing. Wasn't that game brilliant because of its brilliant cinematic? Wasn't it very brilliant narrative, brilliant design? You know, that's the key thing, and that's what we need to start applying all that stuff to. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So the next one is open culture. Game culture is open culture. And what that basically means is that it's open to itself. It's open to its own change. It's an understanding that it is constantly evolving. Do you agree with that?
Recent events might cast some doubt on that, but I think in general, yeah, I think it's, especially because it is so young, you know, I think we're going through right now a little bit of a phase where it is trying to be a little bit self-insulated,
mm-hmm.
but I think that we're going to get past that fairly quickly, and, you know, we've seen some shifts within the gaming culture through the years of going from kind of like the thing that only nerds do to then, like, accepting more types of players, and now I think eventually it's going to become a more fully open, you know, sort of culture, more inclusive culture.
I would argue that the act of becoming mm-hmm. itself mm-hmm. is definition that it's open.
Yeah.
Even if it does have some of that pushback that mm-hmm. you're talking about, bubble.
Well, I mean, speaking of, you know, the openness, that's really what, at least initially, the Wii was trying to do with the sort of, I believe it was the Blue Ocean, mm-hmm. isn't that Blue Ocean strategy? And was fairly successful at getting people of all ages and all, you know, walks of life into playing games. They may not be playing the same sort of games that we normally play, but they are playing games. Another example of that is the mobile gaming space.
Yeah, yeah.
Do I think that necessarily we will come to a point where everyone is playing the same sort, like the same sort of AAA experience on, say, a console? I don't think that's going to happen. So I sort of disagree a little bit with you there, Chris. I don't think it necessarily appeals yeah. to everyone, and I don't think that's necessarily a problem. Just like how not everyone has to like the same type of, like, not everyone likes the same type of film. Some people like action movies, and some people like you know, romantic comedies or whatever.
I think we're agreed there. I think when I mean, like, the gaming culture, I think I mean the idea that you've got a, like, gaming as a thing is the same as movies as a thing.
You know,
I'm not saying that, like,
you mean
the quote-unquote gamer culture.
Right. As opposed to the attitude by people, a lot of people that don't play games that, mm-hmm. you know, gamers are somehow... you know, they're too prone to violence or, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of thing. Like, gamer is, like, a bad thing. It's less of a bad thing now than when I was growing up, mm-hmm. but it used to be, gamers are nerds and losers, and now it's just sort of like, gamers are, potentially violent or potentially misogynistic.
I'm gonna kill you for saying that.
Yeah, whatever it's gonna be, right. And, it's silly because you don't say that sort of thing about people that watch movies or even violent movies or watch, you know, television. You don't say, oh, these people are glorifying and talking about and loving that new TV show Breaking Bad about drugs and violence. Well, they must be drug users and, mm-hmm. and, you know, violent sociopaths or something.
Actually, that has one of the best morals of any show I've ever watched.
Right,
ever.
Right, right. But it's got all the way up to the end. It's got these bad things. It's got these bad things that we're talking about. But when they appear in games, we have all these pundits that go on and talk about it. That don't play these games. And go on and on about how it's, you know, warping people's minds and are negatively affecting society. And so I do hope that we will get to a point where instead of that reaction, the reaction is, oh, look at what it can teach us, look at what it can show us, like something like a Breaking Bad can do.
Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. that level of interactivity that I feel is a lot of the problem that a lot of people they get their head around. Like, you know, definitely, when you watch a movie, you sit there and you watch the movie, you absorb the medium. But when you're mm-hmm. playing a game, you have to interact with the environment. Yeah. You know, there was, what was the game called? Was it Sniper Elite? I think it was, something like that. I can't remember the game, but it was just called Sniper Elite. You played not Sniper Elite. I'm going to kick myself in a minute. Spec Ops The Line. There we go.
Yeah.
Spec Ops The Line. That game, I went to GDC in 2013, and I wanted to go to a talk called The Design, Emotional Design Behind the Spec Ops The Line. And I went to it, and the guy said, you know, when making this game, we realized that this was on the verge of becoming like another violent, brutish shooter for no reason. So we wanted to try and do new things to make sure that the player wasn't just mind-numbingly playing the game, and we wanted them to actually sort of think about their experience. One thing that really stuck with me, he said, there's a part at the end of the game where your character goes full-on mental. Like, they're just running straight through and killing dudes. I think some sort of terrorist setting. And he says, there's a bit where your comms are gone, you're on your own, there's no team with you, and you run down a corridor, and terrorists are popping up, and you shoot them. And there's a bit where this lady, with the burqa on, everything like that, runs out, and all she was supposed to do was run from the corridor past you, going, ah, please don't hurt me, ah. You can shoot her.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can't. Or you don't. And if you shoot her, she dies and goes, oh, why? No. And she dies. But you don't have to. And they said that the reason they put that in is because they really wanted the player to think, why did I just shoot a defenseless woman? Like, no reason. Mm-hmm. And they said that the thing was, is what made it brilliant was the fact that they didn't need to push that sort of emphasis on it. Like, if someone had got ready, right. like, you did a bad thing there, John, you know, or the team went, why the hell did you do that? It would lose all meaning. because they wanted people to accept it like they did a film. They wanted people to accept, they wanted to breathe in what they've done and been like, oh my God, I did that, you know? And yeah, I think that sort of connection is really frightening to people. To think that, you know, if every kill you got in a game really meant something, you would be scarred, you know? Like, we aren't people, we don't go out and kill people on a daily basis, but I kill people online in a video game all the time. And and that it's like when you watch it in a movie, that's why death is more prevalent in a movie, because you're sitting there absorbing everything, but you're actually interacting, and that weirdly is the thing that sort of loses that connection. Like, we had a demo for the new Morpheus, the Sony VR thing. I don't know if you guys heard of that, yeah?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
We were trying it out, and we had a talk, and he said, like, the most bizarre thing they found about this sort of interaction was they got people to try a racing game, and they set up a rig with, like, you know, the pedals in a driving seat with the steering wheel, like, and everything, like, you know, as you, the hardcore, like, sort of racing game fans do. And they were playing, and they found that people got freaked out at the weirdest things. So they had a guy playing it, and the guy was black, but the guy in the game, so he could see his hands, was white, and it freaked him out. He said, this is weird, I'm looking at my hands via the headset, but they're white, what the hell? And what was really odd was they had like a gearbox, a gear stick on the side, and you were supposed to change gears, but the gears on the car was a flappy paddle gearbox, so that when they moved their hands to do it, randomly, their hands would move, like in the real life, but the randomly their fingers would just go keep, like the two fingers would go beep 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 back and forth, and it freaked people out. They were going, why is this happening? And it, and then when they gave him a controller, they said, they were like, oh, it's fine. And it's the less immersive they made it, the more accepting people became. And that's why I think, you know, films are the more thing where people go, oh, it's much more immersive, is because it's a film, you know, you can see that. But the moment you put, the more you give people control, the less immersion there is. It's very much easier to break it. And I think the idea of that scares the living daylights out of people. Like, you give a controller to your mum, and she goes, oh, they panic. Every, you know, the people who don't know the games, they panic. The first thing we see, I don't know if you guys have ever done this, given that someone doesn't play games, they literally panic. They go, what's happening?
I've had that experience with my mom, too.
Exactly, yeah, and it's hilarious, and they shut down.
They go, I don't know what to do. Yeah, and they just hand it back to you.
Because they realize the responsibility, because they've never had it before, you know, and it's there. And that is the sort of the key thing that I feel like that's why it never will be massively socially accepted, because there are just people out there who won't want to do that. They won't want to have that interaction. And, you know, you can't force that on them, because if you try and force this interaction on them, they'll resent it. And that's I think gaming's biggest difficulty in that area, is the fact, you know, you're trying to force this interaction on people who may or may not want it, you know, and you know, it becomes difficult to sort of justify that on a large scale.
I love it. That's awesome. Cultural resistance is the next one.
And adequately leading into that.
It's a stronger word than cultural rhetoric. Rhetoric implies talk back. Cultural resistance is literally looking at a specific thing in the larger culture and saying, no, we will not do that. So I'm curious if you guys can think of some examples where games have successfully, or maybe not so successfully, done that. Just literally put up a big old sign that said, absolutely not.
Are you talking about going against some sort of, like, something accepted in culture, and they're saying, no,
in the most extreme case, but it might be a part of culture. Like, there are a lot of debates in culture, you know. I haven't really seen a game about abortion, for example.
So you mean, like, really hitting really divisive topics.
Really divisive topics.
That would be interesting, though.
That probably exists somewhere, but it's probably, like, a Twine game or something like that. Some, like, very indie, sort of unknown sort of deal. So, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, anything you can think of, there's probably been something done with it. But, of course, we're primarily talking about things that are actually culturally visible. People know about it.
Right. I would have said culturally relevant, but you're a little nicer than me. But, yes. Precisely, though. I agree with you. It is something that I'm sure people have experimented with. But, obviously, just because you make... And I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying that, unfortunately, that's the truth of it, is you have to be able to get it out there where people will actually, you know, absorb it. And
well,
it's not necessarily easy.
I mean, we could look at something like the fact that there have been properties and some games, some movies, some TV series that had a black president long before America had a black president, right? And I'm wondering if I'm not talking conspiracy theories here, but I'm talking about culturally, if we were primed for it before the event happened. You look the same thing in homosexual relationships within mm-hmm. video games and things like that. For 15, 20 years now, we have begun to see that kind of thing come in and become just accepted and common, and you don't have to engage in it. You can choose not to, or you can. And so because that choice is free and available within the context of the video game, now in society we have a decision in the last couple of weeks that has affirmed that cultural change, if you will. That's kind of what I'm talking about, is that cultural resistance.
But kind of working in reverse, so rather than priming us for something, we're priming us against something.
Well, for or against. It works both ways.
Okay.
So that is an example then of cultural resistance.
It's a shunt that makes us go a different direction.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that I think all of our media does or can do. I just think that in terms of like really doing something controversial, really opening up, say, into a debate that people are having, that is like a very strong, touchy subject. I can't think of a game that is. I mean, abortion is a good example of a subject that a game really hasn't touched.
Mm-hmm. The problem is, and it's going to sound so horrible to say this, but those games don't make money. And it sounds really scummy and corporate of it. I feel so horrible saying it, but the sad fact is that these hard-hitting cultural games about sensitive subjects will not get made because it's a damn risk, and people won't take that risk. They want to make their safe Assassin's Creed 27. You know, they want to stick with that. And I love the Assassin's Creed series, but even I can
admit, are on 27 too.
Yeah, we probably are. I love the Assassin's Creed series, but even I can admit that's gone too far. And you know, it's like these games just won't make money. This is why independent game like developers are so important. They keep the game industry humble. They make players go, well, if this team of two people, a dog and a notepad with a computer that was born in the 1990s can make this game feel epic and amazing, why can't you, big old developer with multi-billions of dollars, you know? And it's why that, because I mean, when we talk about games that have impact, I mean, I played a game called That Dragon Cancer.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which I don't, to explain to people who may not know, in short, a man whose child was dying of a very aggressive form of cancer made a very simplistic and very low polygon, very low res game about the struggles of a man trying to live with his son in hospital and work, and there was moral choice in it, and it was heart-wrenching. It was it really highlighted how difficult this person's life was while trying to look after his son. And at the end, I genuinely burst into tears, because at the end of it, like, obviously your son in the game passed away and the father was distraught, and then at the end it just said, you know, at time of this game he is still alive, and it hit me like a truck, and I was like, oh my god. But I knew when I came out of that experience, I knew very much so that it was only ever going to be able to be felt via an independent game, because they've got the balls and the resources and the non-tied by corporations to do something like that. And you know, we wouldn't dare handle a game. You wouldn't see Activision trying to produce a game about abortions or something like that, or touchy subjects, because it just it would tick so many nope boxes of a guys in suits.
They would get people that would boycott it, probably, whenever you do any sort of controversial issue. There'd be people boycotting it from both sides, because both sides would probably think, this one's trying to say this. Even if you're trying to do a balanced look at it and try to give the gamer the choice of going either way for any of these controversial subjects, both sides are going to think that you're being biased against them, and you're going to have a whole bunch of like legal issues where the game would probably be pulled from shelves pretty quickly. Yeah,
very much so. I mean, if you want a game, there's one game recently that I feel like it's done a very good job of talking about these sort of decisions. Has anyone here played Life is Strange?
Yeah.
I won't go into too details, but the attempted suicide in that game. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've got that point yet, Chris.
I have, yeah.
Okay.
I have.
That was handled with such care and such, I mean, it was handled so well and so beautifully and so sort of like true to life that it really hit the point home with a level of subtlety that I haven't seen in a game in a long while. I remember because I haven't had time to play it myself yet, I watched it through via a Let's Player, and I remember getting to that point and thinking, Jesus, I wish I'd played that game myself to experience that, because it was it was so well handled and so well done, with the highest level of respect and care you would expect in quite a sensitive subject of suicide, and I feel like that game is doing very well in terms of score and reviews. People are saying it's one of the best adventure games we've had in years, and I really hope that that game can sort of pave the way so that we can tackle sensitive subjects. You know, it, obviously it's about time travel, so there's a bit of a weird element there, and you can rewind your decisions, but and there's the climax of one of the latest ones is a huge decision. You know, well, if you could go back and change a major event, and that's weird. That game sort of touching on the sort of semi sort of realistic choices. Granted, it's coming from an aspect of fantasy, like you can reverse time, but it is getting to that point. You know, if you could reverse time, would you go back and stop Hitler? You know, that's things like that, and it's cool. And I feel like games are maybe starting to touch on issues like this, because you know we can, they have the capability to do it. It's just a question who will have the stones to do it and try and make money at the same time. Because obviously anything where you try and make money on it just comes off as insincere. Like if you run a charity drive and then say, and then half of the profits are going towards us, everyone will boo you and everyone will stop, you know. But it's kind of like that, and it's going to be difficult. Whoever does that, I will tip my hat to whatever company does it. And Square Enix with Life is Strange, they might get my hat tip if they handle this, the rest of this subject as well. But it is going to be tough. I believe we can do it, though. That's something I do want to stress, despite my negativity. I believe that someone out there will, whether it's with the advent of VR, whether it's ever with, you know, just better game design or game theory or whatever you want to put it, someone will crack it and someone will make that game, and we will go, you know, we'll eat our words. We'll say, no, that was a really good example of this. And so cross fingers it will be sooner than later, rather than later.
And meanwhile, we'll get Zombie Tea Parties Must Die, and you know, we'll have the one where you can go through and kill off Sarah Palin and Newt Gingrich and Rick Santorum, along with the...
We already have those sort of games, the little, like, Flash games, where it's always, like, some political figure or some pundit that people don't like, and they'll make a Flash game, and it'll be, like, you're shooting, like, they pop up, like, Duck Hunt or something, and you're shooting them, or, like, you punch them in the face, or they've got all these...
That's true.
It's, I mean, but those are, like, I don't know if those are really even making a statement other than just like, pure hate that just channeling through a game.
They're just people who can, just expressing themselves.
Right.
You know, that's like...
And I'm not talking against it either. I think that's perfectly acceptable. Oh, yeah. I'm for all of creative expression, even if it's of the hateful and ultimately pointless variety. You know, I'm still... if that's the way you want to get out and express yourself, that's great. We shouldn't be saying no to that stuff, because what happens when you have a society where you tell people they can express themselves, then you're going to actually get people going out and really acting out this stuff in real life. Because that's the whole point of art. It's to get yourself out there and express yourself in a way that's positive.
And we're free to disagree with it. Just, you know, don't stop you from saying it.
So. Except during button mosh.
Right.
Okay, so the last one is cultural environment. Basically, that game culture is its own cultural environment unto itself. It's its own ecosystem unto itself. I mean, this podcast would not exist without that.
Yeah. No, so. Definitely there is a... gaming culture, and I would argue that now there are multiple gaming cultures, if that's what we're talking about. Yep. So I think it was smaller back when I started gaming. It was pretty much everyone was in kind of the same sort of niche and group. We were sort of looked at as somewhat outcast or somewhat weird, I guess, but we all kind of had our own little community, and now there's, I think, multiple communities, because of course we have the academic side as well, where it's sort of meta and examining games and examining even the culture itself, the gaming culture or cultures, as it were.
Yeah.
And especially since we have games in so many different venues now, it's not just you're going to play on your console or your PC, but we've got the mobile spaces. We have games that are much more open, like specifically games that were on the Wii that were played by older people, like elderly as well, like, you know, Wii Bowling and all of that. Or we have the games that... The more interactive, I guess, game experiences that you get at some place like over here. We have this place like Dave and Buster's, or these little arcades and bars where the games are focused on more like movement based games. So it's just kind of like a fun diversion, as opposed to something that you dedicate a large portion of your life to playing and discussing, like we do here. So yeah, I think there's definitely game cultures.
Cool. Yep. Well, let's end this today by personally saying very, very quickly the most offended we've ever been while playing a game. I will begin. That was while playing Manhunt. It's a two-part answer. The first is, while playing Manhunt 1, because of the horrible atrocities I committed, and enjoyed myself doing it. And then the second was whenever Manhunt 2 on the Wii censored all of that terrible gratuity, because while I had signed up to be offended, I in fact was not. It was censoring it for me. And I learned a very valuable lesson in that whole process of realizing that actually what I was enjoying in that moment was the gratuitous violence and the terrible things that I was doing because I was offended by it. And that's what I was signing on for. It's a bit like going to a horror movie and being offended when you're scared.
That is meta.
I don't know. Like, that's an interesting way to put it, offended, because there's been games where I've had that experience, have had a very strong emotional reaction, but I don't think I would ever say I was offended by the game.
No.
Because I expect that. It's like, Manhunt is a good example of where, like, I was, I guess you could say, disgusted by some of the things that I was doing. I wouldn't say that I was offended at all by the game, though, or what was going on.
Excellent.
I don't know if I have an answer for that, to be honest.
Yeah, I can't think of one myself. I tended not to offend easily at anything.
I actually do have one that actually really, really annoyed and offended me, very much so. Back when Call of Duty was riding the coattails of, like, you know, of its success, you know, they knew the influence they had on the industry. They knew they were the best, one of the biggest selling games of all time. They were clearly building up to a franchise. And then they announced Modern Warfare 2. Naturally, the hype was ridiculous. People were excited. You know, Call of Duty 4 was really well received. 5 was kind of less so, but it was still, 4 was still going strong. And then they revealed that the starting scene of the game, you were in a terror situation, and you could just kill people for literally no reason. And they made a point of saying, you can literally just kill them for no reason. Troll. And I remember thinking, like, what's the damn point of this? You are literally just doing this for the sake of being controversial and the sake of going, oh, look, this game lets you kill loads of people. And it offended me as someone, because at the time, I was in university and learning about game design, and it went against everything I'd sort of believed in, because I was sitting there going, like, obviously, I've been a very big advocate since I started in game academia about games for good and games for change. And I was starting that sort of, the ball rolling on that back, even back then. And the fact that they were literally just going, yeah, murder them. Murder everyone. They're in a terrorist situation. We don't care if you can do it or not. And, you know, we can skip the scene and all. And I'm like, yeah, but you've still got it there. You're still encouraging people just to shoot random people. For no reason. If they gave you a score, or if they gave you XP, or there was a relevance to the story, you were held at gunpoint and said, kill them, Sergei, or whatever, you know, whatever. It would have made more sense, but it wasn't, yeah, just kill them all.
I think the justification they had within the game, you're talking about the No Russian scene, right?
Yeah, the start, yeah.
I think the explanation they gave was that you're an undercover agent and basically you had to do this so your cover wouldn't be outed. And then, of course, you find out that they already knew and basically they were using you to set up this war that they were going to be launching.
But the thing that bothered me about it was, like, yeah, when you eventually find out, yeah, you're an undercover agent and they knew, but, like, the thing is, even then, if you go for the whole scene and don't shoot anyone, there's no difference. There's literally no difference, and that's what bothered me. I said, because I wasn't the biggest fan of FPSs back then, and I turned around to my friend who bought it and said, "Did you? What happened? What happens if you go for it and you're shooting one?" And he goes, "Yeah, I tried it. There's no difference." I was like, "Really? They don't say anything? No, nothing at all." And I was like, "Well, what the bloody hell was the point then?" And they're like, "You know, I don't know. Really, it was just sort of there. They could have just made the whole scene walk through. They could have made that scene so much more interesting and better for the player without having to resort to controversy." And it insulted me on an intellectual and as a designer level, because it really bothered me. It was gratuitous violence for no reason, and violence for no reason has always really bothered me against mediums. When there's something I call unfair death in any sort of medium, it really bothers me. Like, characters that die in ridiculous manners or get something bad happens for literally no reason other than just...
For shock value?
Yeah. I mean, have you seen Jurassic World recently? Has anyone seen Jurassic World?
Yes, I did.
Do you remember the spoilers? I'm just going to say now, spoilers. You know exactly what
I'm talking about. I know what you're going to say. I know the exact thing you're talking about.
The pterodactyl one. Remember the pterodactyl? Yeah. That bit.
You mean the girl, the helper girl?
Yeah, the British lady.
Like the nursemaid.
That death would be reserved.
That was the most over the top.
Yeah. It was like first she's being chomped on by a pterodactyl, then she's being chomped on by another pterodactyl upside down, then she's being drowned, then she's being stabbed by a pterodactyl, then she's being eaten alive by a pterodactyl, and then she's eaten by another dinosaur while being eaten by a freaking pterodactyl. I'm like, this death is reserved for the villain! This is how the villain does it! This is not how the nice... Because, like, she did nothing wrong. I thought to myself, was she a cow? Was she nasty? Nope. She was. Nope. No. She was a normal. Yep. Nope. I don't.
The main woman in that movie, the one who was the aunt to the two kids. I forgot her name.
Yeah.
The main person.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was the one that deserved it more because she had basically been. She'd kind of like caused this whole mess in the first place.
Yeah.
If you actually look at it, I mean, they treated her as though she was one of the main characters. I mean, not main character, the protagonist of the movie.
Yeah.
But really, she kind of was behind all of the bad things that had gone on in the park.
Chris Pratt was literally like the real life human being. Like the whole movie is like, you shouldn't do that. Like the audience going, yes, we know. And that sort of unfairness of it all, that really bothers me. And that scene
in that game
tapped on that for me. It's not just limited to films as well. You guys have a TV show called Torchwood, which is a spin off of Doctor Who.
There was a really prominent episode
in that where I won't go through because of lack of time, but one of the father in the show was portrayed as this evil bad guy, and he died in quite a violent manner. A fairy, I say in inverted commas, shoved its hand down his throat and like put his arm pretty much all the way to his stomach and left flowers in there. And obviously he died from that. But his only crime was to tell his stepdaughter off for running off in the forest on her own when she's six. And I'm sitting there going like, so his crime was to be a responsible father. I totally get the message behind this. And then my fiance said to me, but the fairies can't be reasoned with, they're alien. And I was like, yeah, but that doesn't justify his death. And it just harks back to this thing. Like, that sort of level of, that insults me because it's kind of like, you, especially in a game, because like I said before, the interactivity makes it worse in my mind. Like the fact that if I'm watching the movie, I'm like, Jesus, that's unnecessary, but I can't do anything about it. But I can do something about it in that scene, and the fact that it's encouraging me to do something in the scene makes me feel offended that they're trying to force something. And a lot of games since then haven't done that. They've been very adamant about making sure you know you shouldn't be doing this, or it's not kosher, or they tend to skip scenes, or they tend to wrestle control from you as well. A lot of modern games will wrestle, as you might know, they wrestle control and say, now your character's going to do this, and you don't do it. They've learned from that's not kosher, you don't do that. And then that comes with another sort of, you know, thing about, wrestling control from players. But I prefer to wrestle control from a player rather than forcing them to a situation with something they don't want to do, unless it's got a narrative point. So if the character's forced to kill their wife at gunpoint because it's a point to the story because you want to accentuate how bad the villain is, then great, yeah. But don't just give me the option to shoot my wife and then nothing happen. You know, it's really...
Yeah.
Sorry, I get really annoyed about that. That really bothers... To this day, that game really bothers me because of that.
Gotcha.
Well, there we go.
Cool. Well, Bradley, thank you very much for joining us. It's been awesome having you on, man.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Yeah.
It's been really nice to talk about this stuff.
Yeah, cool. Thanks a lot for coming out and listening, or chiming in, I guess. Skyping in. Are we on Chime or whatever the hell?
Google. We're Googling in.
I think I invented a couple of new ones in there somewhere.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, we'll definitely have to have you on again at some point.
It would be my pleasure. Yeah, absolute pleasure.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for joining us for BackwardCompatible.com podcast number 37. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Doug.
I'm Brad.
And we'll see you guys next time.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us what you think about the good, the bad, and the ugly in gaming, and what might happen in the future. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.